All right. Now, Kara, when I first met you, you were already deep into the long form. But when was it that you really discovered your love for documentaries?
It's hard to say when, because I've always loved a good story. Whenever I go out with my parents to like a dinner, and I was a child, I would excuse myself and ask the host, where are your family albums? So I always went through family. I never asked, are there any children here my age? I always asked for the family
albums.
So
you're looking for the story.
So maybe that, or I'm only chismosa, di ba? So I'm always looking for someone's story, always. My dad always watched documentaries, mostly war. But my mom was the journalist. So between the two of them, I guess, I caught the bug somewhere there.
And for Baby Ruth, what was it like for, when was it that you got bitten by that documentary bug?
My God, I think I was 6 years old. I grew up in, you know, in the province from Bulacan. Mm-hmm. And I'm a television baby. And every 4 o'clock Saturday, I would tune at ABS-CBN and watch those afternoon documentaries. And I thought that's my window to the world. And it suddenly made me dream, like, what is it like? You know, all these stories of people from all different walks of life, and it makes you curious and it makes you want to know what's more out there.
You know, documentaries have a distinct way of communicating with a viewer. It's for me, it's like a silent conversation that the film has with the viewer. Was this one of the reasons why you got into it as well, and why documentarists like you guys continue to fall in love with the craft?
It's because, you know, it's like knowing your story, knowing the journey, and knowing the story of a country through documentaries, because you cannot, you know, lie when you talk about real stories. And it's like an adventure to know the truth and to understand life. I've always thought of myself as a student of life. And well, working here at ABS-CBN for quite some time, I got to know different people and their stories. Sabi nga nila, from Kanto to Palacio, you know, we were able to get access to these kinds of stories. And it's amazing. It, you know, it fills us with knowledge, it fills us with wisdom, and it fills us with zest.
And that whole journey of, you know, you're unveiling the truth, skin by skin, layer by layer. That's the whole love, I guess, for it. Now, but there seems to be a resurgence now, Kara, of love for documentaries. Why do you think this is happening?
I think there are a lot of factors. A big factor really is the video streaming now. There's access. It's global access for anyone, which is good for us. And there's just more documentaries, you know, budding here and there, especially even in the Philippines. I guess there's this craving to know the truth and to share the truth. And I would always say that a country without documentaries is like never having met your grandparents or parents, never having seen your family albums from long ago. So you don't know who you are. You don't have a compass. You have no way to navigate your way through the future. You have no imaginings of the future. So more people are more aware. They want to know. There's more knowledge out there, which stimulates more wanting to know. So that's what it is, which is good for us. We need to really know who we are, where we're going.
And that's why there should always be a space for documentaries, especially in a country like ours, Baby Ruth.
Definitely, especially nowadays when there's a proliferation of fake news and there's just so many information left and right. You don't know anymore where to go or what to believe in. So we go back to the basic of documentaries. And luckily, you know, there's this crazy group of women filmmakers. I don't know why, you know, most of the documentary filmmakers in the Philippines are women. So we decided, you know, I made some works, you made some works, and let's just, you know, collaborate and invite the networks.
So why do you think that is? That there are a lot of crazy women filmmakers, and there's, you know, there's a need for the truth, according to us, to be told.
I don't know how to answer, because I always want to be gender blind about those things, so I don't know how to really answer that. But for one, it's a very meticulous, time-consuming task. So I guess right there and then, maybe women have more patience. I don't know. I don't even want to say that. It doesn't seem fair. But so anyway, having said that, I just want to reiterate that we're celebrating the 100 years of documentary making in the Philippines. So it's not just any ordinary festival. In fact, it's actually more than 100 years. We're older than Philippine cinema. So we're gathering over 55 films for people to come see at the UP Film Center March 16 to the 21st. The whole camp, the whole complex of the UP Film Institute will be involved, the back, the front.
Whose
all the
idea
theaters.
Was it to like look back at
we're
the
four
first
friends.
100 years of film?
Yeah, we're four filmmaker friends, myself, Baby Ruth, Jewel Maranon, and Corinne Jimenez. Mm-hmm. I think at any point in our lives, we have dreamt of something like this, whatever form it was, whether it was getting together just the documentary community, showcasing yeah. films. And then there was a spontaneous combustion, which has all got together. We've been planning this for 3 years, and so here we are now. And we're very happy with the reaction and support of everyone, including and especially the TV networks, ABS-CBN and GMA, coming together. Walang competition, nothing.
That
all in
historical.
The spirit of collaboration.
Because you knew as filmmakers, as documentarists, that you knew the wealth of materials that oh, were, yeah. that was out there.
Oh yeah.
We've so you needed something like this
I mean,
to showcase it.
We've discovered what more than 1,500 titles.
Oh my goodness.
And then about 200 documentaries were submitted to us with that limited, you know, time for a call to submit. And it's just crazy. And I thought, you know, as a filmmaker, this is our time. You know, we were, destiny has given us the 100-year mark to do something, to celebrate our story, to celebrate our history. Mm. And what is, you know, the most beautiful way to celebrate it, but to highlight the real stories that happened, you know, 100 years before us, and now we are here. So it's like living, creating a time capsule.
Right.
Right now, and hopefully, you know, the people from 100 years from now, you know, will look at us like, oh, this is the family album that was created for
when
for,
I look at
us.
It, it's sort of like getting to know us again.
Yeah.
Yeah.
From and knowing the, your trajectory.
And knowing where
yeah.
to go
yes.
from here. So when you started collating all of these films, I mean, you have, I think you discovered some films what, from 1911 to 1926? That must have been like, you found gold there.
We're like really geeks for archival
hunters.
Footage. You know, when we saw the footage of even just, let's say, Independence Day, you know, the Philippine flag going up and the US flag going down,
right.
the four of us were excited. And like, kami lang bang ganito? But you know, these are things you read about in the history book, in your history books, and it's gonna come alive.
Mm-hmm.
Not just that, but there are other things we've found that we want to share. It's gonna be the finale. We're going to have it. Not all those films are silent, but mm-hmm. there will be like music, live music played into it, and other programs. But we want to also thank the British Film Institute mm-hmm. for helping us. So Babe Ruth will continue that story
no,
about
yeah.
the other films.
Because I know, remember, you were looking for Kulyon.
Yeah, because my brother said, go to the British Film Institute, 1929. They have it, they have it.
Uh-huh.
And she called a friend and found more.
Yeah, through the help of SOAS University, University of London, mm-hmm. Dr. Christina Huan. She went to the BFI and discovered about, I think, five more titles. Of, like there was a 1911 footage of a relationship between Cebu and London. They were exchanging abaca trade during that time.
Oh my goodness, and we have that on
and
film.
And we have
yeah.
that on film.
That's amazing.
And there's Manila Live, Manila Street in 1911. And I mean, I would love to see that. You
so
know?
You're basically treasure yeah. hunters, as I said earlier, and you
yeah.
just hit the jackpot here.
yeah.
We're
right?
all excited. We're all excited to share that with everyone. It's like, you know, knowing who we are during mm. that time. Like,
but do you think, though, that mm. this will only resonate with geeks like us? Or do you feel that there's an untapped interest there?
We really think that the potential and the power of the mm. documentary is untapped. That's why we're doing this. Admittedly, we will begin with the geeks and people in our community, but it's also for NGOs who want to use some films to promote their advocacy. It's for anyone who wants to see a good story.
Mm-hmm.
Because in anything you do, you need to always tell a story, whether you're selling property or you're selling a dress.
Mm-hmm.
There's always storytelling, but all of us need to know something that we're clueless about, but need to know or care about, but we didn't really care about before. There's so many things we need to do to be more proactive citizens in this country. It's so untapped the potential. I mean, documentaries can really promote peace. They can bring down governments. It's part of the creative economy. We can be part of national strategy. We're not being used for that.
Mm-hmm.
And so we really, really are trying to invite everyone, come out of your comfort zone and give it a chance. Try to fall in love with this genre.
At the very least, it's something that could, you know, propel you to search for your real identity.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah.
Especially as a country.
Especially for the young people and young Filipinos, you know, who don't really know where they came from. Mm. Like, you know, we grew up with Facebook and maybe post
because
and so
somewhere,
on.
Somewhere along the road, someone dropped the ball, and you have this entire generation who doesn't care much for history, who doesn't really want to look back. This is going to be for them too.
Yes, exactly.
And I think the more you watch truthful films, you
get interested.
You kind of sharpen your instinct to also know what's the truth.
Yes.
You can sort easily.
Whether it's about the environment.
You can see the sincerity of a filmmaker. Yes.
Whether it's about the nation.
It's health.
Yeah.
We have five themes: ecology, nation, localities, taboos, things you don't want to talk about, and we talk about the future. Mm. And we have panel discussions every day. The first day on nation is moderated by Boya Bunda. The second day is ecology, moderated by Atom Araulio. The third day we talk about taboos. It's moderated by Shara Zambrano and Junza Baiton. And fourth day we talk about, the theme is localities, narrated by, moderated by Dr. Michael Tan, the Chancellor of UP Now. Mm-hmm. And the last day is about the future, moderated by
Lord
May Paner.
Yeah, we're working on more guests to moderate for us.
But the opening day is hosted by Cheche Lazaro.
Of course, you're going to have
I know, the queen of integrity.
I mean, you started with her.
Yeah, I started with the probe team and so many other people there. Yes. The alumni have become documentary filmmakers. In fact, the people in charge of documentary teams at the helm at ABS and Jim are both from the probe team.
Mm, now, Daang Dokyu will be happening in 2 weeks. Right?
Yes.
It's March 16th is the beginning. Kara just gave us a glimpse of, you know, the talks and the films, the different aspects of it, the vignettes that we'll be focused on. But how tedious was the process in screening all the films, all 55, so that you whittle it down to just 55 of the best?
Yeah, that's the challenging part of mounting a festival like this one. And, you know, especially the birth pains of looking at all those, researching at all those films and making sure that a group of curators who can represent different themes and different sectors are there to put voice on these stories. So, yeah, there are curators that we looked up to, like Teddy Ko, Commissioner of the National Commission for Culture and the Arts. There's Ajani Arumpak, who is a representative of the Mindanao Voice, and Professor Sari Delena, who works at the University of the Philippines Film Institute. So they are our compass to make sure that, you know, all these films are within the radar and looked after. And also, it's actually the tedious part of really making sure that you look everywhere.
Right.
And it's the limited time as well. So it's like, I don't know, it's like there's a treasure hunt, you know, going on to find all these films.
On timer.